Okay, now if you'll turn to Your Voices United number 27, we're going to try to learn a new hymn that's in the service a little later. Suzanne Campbell is going to come forward, and Ellen will play through once, then Suzanne, and we'll start to sing it, and maybe we can join her.
Verses 1 and 2 together. Ready? Here we go.
Tomorrow Christ is coming as yesterday He came. A child is born this moment. We do not know its name. The world is full of darkness. Again,
good morning, and welcome to this service of worship. We welcome those who worship with us via Eastlink television. We welcome any who are visiting with us this morning and any who are new to our congregation. We pray that this worship will be a blessing to all of us. Following the worship of service, we're all invited down to the gym for coffee and conversation. And I hope that you will join in that fellowship. And on your way down to coffee and conversation, you might want to pass through the lower hall across from the chapel this morning beside the parlor. Jams and jellies will be on sale if you wish to pick up a little gift for someone or for yourself. This morning, participating in worship, our candle lighters are Linda Dunning and Isla Matheson, both members of our choir. There are several notices in your bulletin. Among them are that today's bulletins are in loving memory of Mrs. Hilda LePage Wanacott, presented by her sons Earl and Don and their families. Also, sympathies of the congregation are extended to the family of the late Betty Hogan, and also to the family of Margaret Hatcher on the death of her sister, Jean Clough. Sympathy also to Kay and Graham Linkletter on the death of Kay's brother, Melvin Ellis, in Oromocto, New Brunswick. And sympathy to Blanche Jenkins and her family on the death of her husband, Stuart Jenkins. We pray that God will comfort all of those who mourn in these days when we long for celebration. May God's presence be real and comforting. And happy birthday. Happy birthday to David Yonker, and happy birthday to Joyce Kaiser and her daughter, Let It Slip, that this Saturday Joyce will be 91 years old. Happy birthday. There are many other notices in your bulletin. Notices of committee meetings this week, the Outreach Committee, the Property Committee, and the Space Review Committee. And also this Thursday is the turkey dinner, which is set up by the Outreach and Service Committee, the turkey dinner which is put on for the students and staff at Prince Street School. And there's still need of volunteers to help prepare and to serve, and financial donations are always welcome. That's this Thursday at noon. In addition to those in church or in-house meetings and events, there are also other notices in your bulletin. Sing Noel today at 3 p.m. here at Trinity. Kathy Burke's book signing this week at Confederation Plaza. So please read those so that you may take in those things in which you're interested and support the people involved. But let us now take a moment of silence to come more fully into the presence of our gracious God. Ye leave your exile behind. God is calling us home.
We'll follow the way through the desert.
Enter the desert without fear. God's water will quench our thirst. Travel the highway with joy, for God is leading to life in abundance. Come, let us worship.
Advent is here. It comes every year. Are you ready? Each year, Advent comes round, and we make the journey to Bethlehem.
Join us in the journey to Bethlehem.
Once again, the Christ child will be born into every heart. Our joy in God will be renewed.
Join us in the journey to Bethlehem.
The wreath is ready. Just a touch of a match, the candle of joy is lit, a flickering light that will lead us to the joy of God. And we say together, Bethlehem, There we will find joy in our hearts, joy for our lives, joy for our relationships, joy for the world.
Let us pray together. You are the joy of the world, God. You are the guiding light of our lives. Open our minds to your joy. Open our hearts to your presence. Open our eyes to your world, that we might be the incarnation of hope everywhere we go. We ask in the child's name. Amen. Let us join in singing the first two verses of hymn number 28, Hark, Sound, Herald, Sound the Note of Gladness. And during the singing of that, the boys and girls are invited to come forward for a story.
Good morning, everyone. This Sunday is the third Sunday of Advent and the Sunday that we think about joy. Joy, that's a lovely kind of word, isn't it? Joy. So I'm going to tell you a story about a boy named Dane. And he was sitting on Monday morning having his breakfast and thinking about how he had heard the day before at church that it was the week that we think in Advent about joy. And while he was sitting there thinking about joy, he heard his sister upstairs yell to his mother, "Mom, I can't find my favorite shirt. Didn't you wash it yet?" She didn't sound very joyful. But anyway, he wasn't really sure what happened with the shirt because he got busy getting ready for school and out he went to catch the school bus. And he got on and he sat down, and when they got to the next stop, somebody got on, and somebody else stuck out their foot and tripped the person when they were going down the aisle of the bus. And the person fell. And Dane looked and thought, that was a very nice thing to do. And Dane started thinking about, this isn't really what I think of when I think of joy. And so he started watching people that day. And he noticed at lunchtime that somebody's milk spilt at school. But he was pretty sure it hadn't spilt by accident. And somebody else had pushed it over. And he thought, that wasn't very good. And then he noticed in the afternoon, he noticed one of the boys teasing another one of the boys. And then when somebody in class gave the wrong answer to a question, everybody laughed. And Dane went home thinking, this is not what joy is about. And by the time he got home, he wasn't feeling very much joy himself. In fact, he was really kind of grumpy. And he got home and he sat down in a chair and he felt this lump behind him, and he reached back and he pulled out this sock, nice big fluffy sock of his sister's. And he was about to like throw it down. He thought, oh, probably his mother dropped it when she was folding the laundry. And then he looked at the sock and he got an idea. And so he went upstairs and he did something with the sock. And then he went back downstairs, and it wasn't very much longer before he heard his sister yell to his mother, "Mom, there's candy in my sock." And he thought she sounded pretty happy. So the next morning, he lay in his bed, and when he heard his sister get up and go into the bathroom, he jumped up and he snuck into her room and he made her bed. And when she came out of the bathroom, he was downstairs at the kitchen table having a cereal and he heard, "Mom, somebody made my bed." And he kind of felt good about that. When he got to school that day, his teacher was not in a very good mood. Her car hadn't started that morning, and she was late. And when she got there, she was getting some paints out for craft time, and she spilled some on her shirt, and she was just not having a very good day. And Dane wondered what he could do about that. And so at lunchtime, when everybody went out to get all their coats and stuff on, he stayed back, and he wrote on the blackboard, "You're the best teacher in the world." And then after, when they came back in from recess, he tried not to look at his teacher because he didn't want her to see the grin on his face. But she spent the whole rest of the afternoon smiling. Well, it snowed that afternoon, and when he got home, he thought, "I'm going to make a snowman. This is great snow for making a snowman." And he was just looking at where he might make the snowman in the yard, when he looked across the road and he noticed his neighbor's driveway hadn't been shoveled. And Mrs. Higgins was kind of elderly and couldn't walk that well. So Dane got an idea. He didn't walk straight across the road. He kind of snuck down the road and crossed and came back up where she couldn't see her driveway from her house. And he shoveled out her driveway. And then he snuck back home, and by that time he was kind of cold, so he made himself a hot chocolate. And he sat down in the kitchen, and he looked out the window, and he watched. And he watched when Mrs. Higgins' garage door opened, and she came out kind of using her shovel a little bit like a cane. And he watched her stop and look at her driveway, all shoveled already. And he watched her look up and down the street, and he saw her start to smile. And then Dane realized something else. He was smiling too. Let's say a prayer and you say the words after me. Thank you, God, for today. Thank you for joy. Help us to spread joy to others. Amen. Let's head off to Sunday school.
Oh. Will you listen with me? Listen with me to the words of Luke 1, 46 to 55. The Magnificent, it's called. Mary's song. Mary goes to visit Elizabeth, to meet, to chat, to be with each other, to support each other. This is Mary's song. Listen with me to the words that she has to share with every age and every time, the words of wisdom. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is God's name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation unto generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever and forever. May Mary's song and Mary's words and Mary's thoughts percolate throughout our lives in this season and every season of our lives to be a people of God. God carriers. All glory and praise be to God this day and forevermore. Amen. Thank you, choir, and Don, for your gift of song and music this morning. Thank you. Will you join with me in prayer? Great God, words seem so very inadequate to speak of you and you in our lives. And yet you've given us a word to speak, as you've given Mary a word to speak. And in fear and trepidation, we open our mouths and we open our hearts and we open our lives to you to be surprised. And so, O God, as I share with this congregation, as my words and thoughts and our lives mingle together, may we, O God, be strangely warmed by a spirit that takes even the most feeble words that we say and create the most beautiful moments of learning within our lives. May it be so this morning. Amen. I had never met Mildred before. I'd not met her until I went to a board meeting. I was a new person who was invited to be on this particular board. I noticed very quickly Mildred was a quiet sort. She didn't say a lot. She wasn't a large woman. She was small in stature, graying hair. I would even say she was a bit shy. I learned later that Mildred had been part of this board for many, many years, that she was a passionate woman for the work of the board, and she worked tirelessly, and she had a heart of gold. Now, I was pretty eager to meet the members of the board and to start participating in the organization and help move the organization along. And as many of you know, I'm a bit of an A-type personality and a little hyper and just want to get going. And I attended my first meeting, and there was a lot of discussions, a lot of opinions being shared, and there were strong voices at that meeting and strong voices around the table as we spoke and as we shared. There were successful business people there. There were well-educated people there. There were people who had traveled the world who spoke and sat around that table. They seemed all very important to me then. Most were eager to express their thoughts and ideas and were very forceful in doing that. And as a newbie sitting around the table, I was observing what was happening, and I noticed Mildred. Mildred sat quietly, but she was obviously very much engaged and very much participating in the conversation, and you could see her mind working as she engaged. Well, after much discussion and really no way forward in our discussion, Mildred, in her quiet voice, began to speak. The room fell silent. It was as if everybody seated around that table knew when Mildred spoke, she was speaking of something that was important and had something important to say. People listened to Mildred. I learned to appreciate Mildred the more and more I was invited to be part of her life. And I knew that when Mildred spoke, she didn't waste time nor words. She went right to the point. It felt like those times at the symphony, if you've been at the symphony. You know, when the orchestra is tuning up and all you hear is cacophony. Harsh, discordant mixture of sounds making no sense. And then the director taps her baton, and the room falls silent. And for that brief moment, between the tap of the baton until the music begins, there is that poignant presence or pause where people take a deep breath and as if they're leaning in to hear what's going to come next. It's a holy moment. You can feel those gathered waiting for the first bit of music, the anticipated music, waiting for the move from cacophony to something very different, very beautiful, like another world altogether. Throughout most of the year, we have heard from many storytellers given to us through our Holy Scriptures. We've heard from prophets. Now, on this third Sunday of Advent, we listen to another kind of prophet, a simple maiden who comes not from the wilderness, but from her own little obscure village to visit her older cousin Elizabeth. Mary and Elizabeth are women with voices that are sometimes drowned out, as we see voices in our world and in our society sometimes drowned out. But they have something important to say. And in Mary's case, a song to be sung. Women were definitely not at the top of the heap in the minds of the biblical tellers of that day, especially not when there's an actual priest in house. Zechariah, a professional, licensed and learned, knows what he's talking about, an expert in matters of faith. But in our story that I didn't share the whole story, ironically, Zechariah is the very one in the scene without a voice, literally, since he's been struck speechless during his angelic visit. So the stage is set this week, then, for us to have the rare opportunity to hear from the woman for change. And what a change her dream provides. Amid the cacophony, there is the gentle and powerful words of those who we seldom hear. It will do us well in all seasons to sit, to listen, to keenly hear. So how will we hear the message from this teenage girl who is pregnant out of wedlock? How do we hear that? How will we listen to a poor peasant, pregnant teen, who tells her fiance that she is pregnant, but don't worry, Joe, it's by the Spirit? That she knows this because an angel came to visit with her and told her so. How do you hear that message? Put away your angelic thoughts. How do you hear that message? How would you hear this message if Mary were your daughter, your friend, your fiance, your lover? The gospel writers tell us this pregnant teen, Mary, is theotokos. Isn't that a wonderful word? Theotokos. God carrier, God bearer. She has something to say. This girl is a chosen one. In my experience, if Mary was a poor homeless gal on the street today, like the one who's portrayed on the screen before you, we would probably be looking for medical help for her. We would not be listening beyond, we could not and would not listen beyond what we would see before us. Because I'm sure all of us at time have walked the streets of Charlottetown, have seen people sitting there, and we've not made eye contact but continue to go along. And yet Mary is one of those. The stories of our faith tells us that God's favor rests upon those very people we least expect to find God, and certainly not those who are carrying God. Theotokos. Amid the cacophony of voices, there is a voice, and there are voices continuing today to cry in the wilderness. There is a still small voice of God in those whom we have written off and have determined they have nothing to say to us. They cannot share anything with us. Meister Eckhart, a medieval mystic and theologian, wrote these words. He says, "We are all meant to be theotokos, mothers of God. What good is it to me," he says, "if this eternal birth of the divine child takes place unceasingly, but does not take place within myself? And what good is it to me if Mary is full of grace and I am not also full of grace? What good is it to me for the Creator to give birth to the child if I do not also give birth to God in my time and in my culture? This then is the fullness of time when the child of God is begotten in us." Each of us here bear the hope of the world in our bodies, and in our actions, and in our lives. You are the ones who will bear God into the future, old and young, fertile and barren, child and adult, rich and poor, homeless people and those with homes. In the unlikeliness of containers, God has seeded hope for the lowly, justice for the downtrodden, and you, my friends, are also the Marys of this world. This table that is prepared this morning for each of us to come and share, and no one will be refused as Jesus refused no one in his ministry. This table is open, by the way. This table is one such place where this hope is remembered. This table serves as a reminder that each of us as a story of God to tell. Each of us have a seed within our lives that will bring birth to new life and new hope as people of God into our world. Theotokos, each of us, mothers of God. What a gift. And now may we become pregnant with hope and give birth as we move from this season into the next, to a world of justice, a world of care, and a world of hope. And may our song be sung loudly and be sung carefully and be sung graciously and be sung kindly to all whom we embrace, to all whom we reach out, because it is mingled with the God in whom we worship. All glory and praise be to God this day and forevermore. Amen. If you are able, I would enjoin you. If you are able to stand, I'd invite you to stand and sing together our hymn, which is 18. There's a voice in the wilderness.
Oh,
Please be seated. I just need to give a little bit of instruction before we enter into our communion, our Eucharist. Today you will not be served in the pew, but you're invited to come forward. And there will be two stations. There'll be a station here, and there'll be a station over where Gail is standing. The first person that you'll meet is a person with the bread. You'll take the bread, and you can consume it. And then the next person on this side and on the other side of Gail will have the juice, a cup. So you take the cup and you can consume it. And if you can move along here on either side, there's a little basket over there. You can put your cup right in that basket and then continue back to your seat. I'm going to ask, just for so that it's a little orderly and that sort of stuff, that we come up this center aisle on the aisles, receive, move out, and then go back the side aisles and go back to your seat. Hopefully that's not too confusing. We'll give you little whispers up here to move you along if need be. The other thing, we are also very aware that the standing and the moving and that is a challenge for some people. And that's just a part of who we are and the stages. And as a family, these are some of the things that where we are. So if you would like, we're going to have people in the congregation or a couple people who will have bread and juice. And you'll see them. They'll be standing. If you can just put up your hand, they will go and make sure that you are served as well in the pew. Okay? Thank you. Come, all who listen for hope. Here is a place where all are welcome. Here is a place where you can rest in the heart of love.
Let us pray. Holy One, you shaped creation and placed your grace within us. Your song of hope has run out from ancient days, beckoning us to listen and join in. The young woman named Mary opened her heart to your song. She heard the promise that she would give birth. She heard the promise that this child would transform the world, and she believed. In the stillness of this Advent season, we wait and prepare as our hearts echo an ancient cry,
O come, Emmanuel.
We prepare for Emmanuel, God with us. We remember how this child, born in a stable, lived a life of healing, mercy, and wisdom. We remember a special meal shared with friends. Gathering them together, Emmanuel spoke with boundless love. In the blessing of the bread, Emmanuel asked them to share the bread of life.
In the blessing of the cup, Emmanuel asks us always to remember.
We remember your life, your words, your love. As we share this bread and cup, strengthen our hope in the promises of this season and give us courage to live in the way of peace and joy.
Come, for all is ready.
Okay. Let us pray. Spirit of life, though we live in a world of great need, here we have tasted hope and hunger for a world more just. Here we have glimpsed the dream of justice renewed. May we have the courage to be bread and wine for one another. Amen. God's word of joy is coming into the world, joy for a better world. And in anticipation of God's joy, let us offer our gifts, preparing for the coming of Christ among us. Let us pray together. With these gifts, dear God, accept the praise and thanksgiving of our hearts, which rejoice in your goodness and love. Let these gifts point to your presence in the world and further your hope for the world through Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Let us join in singing hymn number 27 in Voices United. Tomorrow, Christ is coming.
Tomorrow, Christ is coming.
Let us go forth with eyes to see and ears to hear and voices to proclaim in the work of justice, in the practice of mercy, in good news for the poor, in the vision of peace.
Thank you. think she didn't, you didn't have to drive in through.